In 1959, four major jazz albums were made that changed music forever. Miles Davis' Kinda Blue, Dave Brubeck's Time Out, Charles Mingus' Mingus-a-um, and Ornette Coleman's The Shape of Jazz to Come.
1959 was a very important jazz year for me and my own development and the evolution of jazz up until now and beyond.
It was a year that saw the biggest selling jazz album and single of all time.
Time Out was going where I envisioned jazz should go. I said, boy, this is fine. This is gonna work.
Jazz was pushed to new heights of innovation, beauty, and groove.
You know, the things would swing. Yeah, he'd lift you right out of your seat.
It was the end of the Eisenhower era, 2.5 children, and the white picket fence. In 1959, jazz is reaching white America in a big way.
Oh, why are they so sick and ridiculous? They brainwash and teach you hate.
Jazz musicians didn't really, like, join the Civil Rights Movement. The Civil Rights Movement actually joined them.
And with Ornette Coleman's The Shape of Jazz to Come, 1959 saw the birth of a whole new free jazz movement.
When you talk about somebody speaking through their instrument, like actually hear it as a human, that's Ornette. He changed everything.
1959 was a phenomenon. It was on another level. That's all you can say.
We don't get you.
When I play though, I'm gonna raise my horn a little bit.
Okay, just you four guys in this, right? One out.
Five.
Ready?
Miles Davis' Kind of Blue is the biggest selling jazz album ever made, shifting over 5 million copies. It regularly tops best jazz album polls, as well as featuring high in lists of the greatest albums of any category. Kind of Blue continues to convert more people to jazz than any other recording. All this 50 years after it was released.
Yeah.
Let's hear a little bit of it.
Right.
When they walked into the studio, they did not see this as their ultimate statement. They did not see this as the birth of a classic. It was a session that was scheduled for that day.
After Cannonball, you play again, and then we'll come in and end it.
They go over by the piano, and he's giving them instructions about the tunes we're going to play, you know. So, you know, there wasn't a whole lot of music. I didn't have any music at all. You know, just a piece of manuscript paper with some chords scribbled on it. Miles tells me, make this sound like it's floating.
Here we go. Note title. Start again, please. Sorry. We gotta watch it because the noise is all the way through this. This is so quiet.
First time I did it, the engineer said, the drums are making like a surface noise. So Miles hollered back at him and says, that's part of it.
That goes with.
What?
Amazingly, Miles and his band spent a total of just 7 hours recording Kind of Blue. All but one of the tracks are first takes.
Anytime they completed a tune, that's what they were going to stick with. You know, it really is propelled by the idea that first thought is best thought.
Try it again, Irvin.
We would be hard-pressed to find any album opener that can compare to the opening of So What. This misty, unclear idea of where is the music going, where are we?
The intro for So What was totally improvised, had no time reference, no beat yet.
And it's the piano and the bass sort of having this little conversation, and out of this musical cloud comes the riff, the grand riff, the one that says, so what? Bom-ba-doom-ba-doom-ba-doom-boom. And then just when the energy is sort of like getting to the point where it needs to be kicked up a notch, Jimmy Cobb comes in with this incredible cymbal crash.
When we got to the place where the solos were supposed to start, I hit the cymbal, and I thought I had overplayed it for the room. I thought I had hit it too hard.
But bang, it hits. You know, you can't plan on stuff like that happening. Miles' solo kicks off. So simple. Almost like a whispered confession, you know, by someone very intimate to you.
When Miles did Kind of Blue, it opened up a whole new direction in jazz. A more introspective, a new way of thinking about the creation of jazz and the creation of jazz compositions.
Part of Kind of Blue's enormous influence on music is the legacy of the band members. Many of them went on to become leaders in their own right, like saxophone virtuoso John Coltrane. But Kind of Blue is defined by Miles' incredibly hip trumpet sound.
He had this sound that was kind of like a haunting kind of voice. It was really individual, very unique, very special. The way he plays, sometimes it makes you feel life so deeply that you can almost cry, you know. And it didn't really sound like a trumpet anymore.
Miles' trumpet technique on Kind of Blue was something he'd painstakingly developed since he first hit the scene in the late 1940s. Back then, the music had been changing.
In the 1940s, if you were a player, if you were an instrumentalist who was really starting to, you know, try and make the move, bebop was the music.
Bebop was a fast and frenetic style of jazz. It reflected jazz musicians' desire to be accepted as virtuoso artists, masters of their instruments. Bebop's greatest exponent was Charlie Parker.
Miles Davis is a very precocious musical youngster. What he really wants to learn is bebop. And where he's going to learn it is on 52nd Street and up at Minton's up in Harlem, playing with the bebop leader of that time, Charlie Parker.
Aged only 18, Miles became a member of Charlie Parker's band. As Miles traded solos with his hero, he was learning about bebop from the source.
Miles is not going to be a sideman for long. Miles, like many of the other musicians of that day, were trying to deal with the language of bebop. Where do we take bebop? Miles said, the music has become cluttered.
Part of his genius as a musician was that he edited what he heard Charlie Parker play. So if Charlie, for instance, used 10 notes to make a certain kind of a statement, Miles Davis might figure out how to use 3. Miles used what they call the harmonic bomb, that you hit this note that nobody expects to hit, and it has a greater power than just running up to the note another kind of a way.
There's a connective between these four artists, Charles Mingus, Dave Brubeck, Miles Davis, and Ornette Coleman, in that they're all dealing with bebop and the continuation of bebop. Where do we take this language? What do we do with it?
Another direction jazz took in 1959 was the rhythmic experimentation of pianist Dave Brubeck's Time Out. A highly unusual record, each track is in a different tempo and time signature. The single, Take Five, is in 5/4 time and built around a drum solo. Yet it rose up the pop charts, becoming the best-selling jazz 45 ever released. Brubeck had spent years building the lineup of his quartet that would go on to record Time Out.
I put together, gradually, this dream group. Because some bass players and some drummers didn't want to play in different time signatures, didn't want to follow where I went.
But Take Five drummer Joe Morello was originally unhappy coming into a band dominated by Brubeck and saxophonist Paul Desmond.
On the marquee, on any kind of sign, it would say the Dave Brubeck Quartet featuring Paul Desmond, and the other guys were nothing. It could have been zilch, you know.
And I said, Joe, I'll feature you. So the first night he joined, I gave him a drum solo.
I did the drum solo in that place. Went wild and people just stood up and clapped and all this nonsense. Paul Desmond, in the middle of the end of the solo, he just walks off the stand and runs in the dressing room.
And Paul said, either he goes or I go. And I said, Paul, he's not going.
Which was a shock, you know. He was a star in the group, not Dave, it was Paul. Well, he felt that way anyway. He didn't talk to me for about 5 months, you know.
I'll work on the ending.
Did I play too many things for you?
I sat in the crossfire between these two wonderful players, keeping everything going and giving in or not giving in. And that quartet just started making real headway.
By the time they signed to Columbia Records in the mid-50s, the Dave Brubeck Quartet were one of America's top jazz bands.
His music was easily accessible to the average person. It was not too complicated, and the group was quite appealing because here you had four all-American young boys to watch as well as to listen to. Dave was quite easy to sell to Middle America because he looked like Middle America. He talked like Middle America. He was a nice guy that you're glad your daughter is going out with.
Brubeck's success widened. Parts of the jazz community accused him of being not only a sellout, but effectively a racist who diluted black music for mass consumption.
Jazz came out of black America. I mean, later, of course, white America catches up, and it always does. But there definitely was a resentment amongst black musicians regarding Dave Brubeck. In the 50s, the people who actually got successful from cool jazz were primarily white musicians.
See, he had broken into another audience that nobody really had. That's when people started getting mad at him. The thing about Dave is kind of strange for a guy who's light years away from a racist, right? Who's light years away from a commercial guy, who doesn't make recordings with any intention of pandering to the public, right? But the public likes him.
Brubeck himself was more concerned with fine-tuning the rhythm section of his quartet and tackling his ideas about where jazz should be headed.
And then Eugene Wright joined us, and finally, I had this dream group.
But the addition of bassist Eugene Wright didn't pass unnoticed when they toured universities in the southern states of America.
We were playing in a university, and they said, you can't go on stage with an African-American. And I said, well, then we're not going on stage. And then the students were stamping on the floor up above the dressing room. And the louder and wilder it got, the more concerned the president of the college was getting. So he told me, you can go on, but you have to put your bass player way in the back where there won't be too noticeable. When we walked on stage, the audience just went wild. They were so happy. The second tune, I told Eugene, your microphone's broke. Come out here and play your solo and use my speaker's mic in front of the band. Gene didn't know how I was plotting all this. He came out and we tore that place up. Oh, it was so wonderful. Yeah.
The classic lineup of the Dave Brubeck Quartet that would go on to record Time Out was now in place.
Thank you.
player and composer Charles Mingus saw the question of how to take jazz forward in a different way. Mingus had risen through the ranks, playing in the bands of jazz legends like Louis Armstrong, Duke Ellington, and Charlie Parker. But for the notoriously opinionated and hot-tempered Mingus, jazz wasn't a calendar history of styles so much as an ever-present now.
Charles Mingus had a very strong sense that there was no past, there was no present, there was no future. All of the time was alive at the same moment. He was a great, great thinker about music. He didn't buy anything about that, you know, a style lasted from 1920 to 1930. Mingus didn't buy that. His thing was that if it was good then, it's good now. He wanted the freedom to play in, to write in, to encourage his musicians to know how to improvise in every style.
In 1959, Mingus recorded and released Mingus-a-um. It was one of four albums he made that year, not unusual in this prolific artist's long career. But Mingus-a-um was a tightly focused masterwork.
The title of the album sounds like a stutter before, while he's getting himself together to make his grand statement. You know, what's that about? What's really, really devastating about is the consistency. Tune by tune by tune. I mean, it's Mingus at his best. Mingus was digging deep into that roots thing with that incredible opening track. Better get it in your soul. It's like a gospel choir. It's like a Pentecostal performance on a Wednesday night prayer meeting. But the incredible magic of it is not just the influences. It's how Mingus works it all together and makes it into its own new thing.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Remember, no applause and keep it down. Your drinks, no rattle your ice in your glasses, and don't ring the cash register. You got it covered? All right.
He had these enormous hands, and that made it possible for him to do certain things technically that just other bass players couldn't do. In fact, he was one of the greatest bassists in jazz. Well, he was one of the greatest players of the bass, period.
I can hear him now. He was powerful. Powerful. You shut up when he played. Charlie Mingus was a big man with a big talent and a big temper. And people bugged him in the audience for some reason. Someone did. He got very angry, took his bass, and he smashed it through the light up there and broke it. The light's still there, the Mingus light. That's what it's become. He ripped the front door off once, and some little gal this big dragged it home, as I recall.
They they say a lot of musicians never played better in their life than when they played with Mingus, because he was so demanding. And he used everything. He used anger, he used insults, he used flattery, whatever he could use. He would fire musicians and hire them back, you know, 20 minutes later. Nothing was out of bounds.
He wanted you to understand his play, his music, and be yourself in it. So often on a nightclub stand, he would stop and say to somebody, you're not playing yourself, you're playing notes.
I knew that Mingus was playing in this little club on West 4th Street, and I went into the club. There was an argument on the bandstand, they weren't even playing, and I heard Mingus like yelling at somebody, and it turned out to be the piano player. Mingus put his arm inside the piano, and he grabbed the strings and pulled them out with one fist. I said, man, it's time for me to get out of here. I'd never seen anything like that in my life.
Well, I'm gonna shoot it. A gun.
People are always telling me stories I don't want to hear about moments of Charles's volatility or things that took place, and in take place they did. And Charles created scenes. He was called Jazz's angry man, and he had plenty to be angry about. He had a lot to confront in those days for a man of his sensitivity and his sensibility and his talent, and unrecognized in many places merely because he had the wrong skin color. He wasn't dark enough and he wasn't light enough. He said, well, he called himself a mongrel or a mutt.
Like many jazz artists, Mingus was an extraordinary player and improviser. But with Mingus-a-um, he began to assume his position as one of jazz's greatest composers.
I love self-portrait in three colors. A little through-composed piece without any solos, just a little gem. Beautiful, this multifaceted composition. Charles once said that he was, through his music, trying to express who he was. And he said the reason it was difficult is because he was changing all the time. But through his music, you hear the fear, you hear the spirituality, the tenderness, the passion. Everything that he was comes out in his music.
In 1959, Ornette Coleman made his spectacular musical statement in one quantum leap with the audaciously titled The Shape of Jazz to Come. But before he formed his quartet, Coleman, based in Los Angeles, had trouble finding anyone who was interested in his wildly unorthodox music.
Went over to this club by MacArthur Park on Wilshire called The Hague, and Jerry Mulligan was playing there. They started their first set, and after they began to play, a guy came in and asked if he could sit in. He got up on the bandstand and proceeded to take out his horn, and the horn was white. It was plastic, you know. I'd never seen a plastic horn before, you know. This guy started to play, it was like, you know, the heavens opened up for me because I saw and I heard something that I'd been feeling.
To me, they were playing as if the music was written. You know, when they was improvised, it was sounds like, oh, they've already learned that, you know. So I said, oh, I don't want to play like that. I want to play directly from something that inspired me. And they said, what are you doing? And I said, well, I'm improvising. So you ain't playing shit. you can't play like that. So play like what? The way you're playing.
And all of a sudden, Jerry Mulligan asked him to stop. So he stopped and got off the bandstand and went to the back door. So I rushed through the crowd trying to reach him. And by the time I got to the back door, he disappeared down the alley. He was gone.
Blown away by Ornette's playing, Charlie Hayden soon tracked him down.
I said, I heard you play the other night, man. You sounded so brilliant. He said, thank you. He said, not many people tell me that. And I said, man, I just wish that we could play music together sometime. And he said, well, what about now? And so went to his apartment. That's how I met him, and we played and played and played, and I might want to stay in there for 3 or 4 days, I don't know. So that's when the quartet started.
There are a bunch of young players, players who are just starting to break out and whose minds and approaches are still flexible enough that Ornette can work with them.
Never worried about chords, melodies, or keys, only sound. And the thing about it, there's only 12 notes that's satisfying the whole world. 12 notes is satisfying the whole world. I said, oh man. And then I realized that this note don't have a style. Either you make something out of it or you don't.
Ornette Coleman's The Shape of Jazz to Come didn't initially make the bold impression it has done in the years since 1959.
First, I didn't know what to make of it. You know, I didn't know which pocket to put it in because I hadn't heard anything quite like that. It was a new, far-out approach.
The Shape of Jazz to Come is definitely an audacious title. You know, it's putting yourself out there and saying, you know, this is where jazz is going.
Lonely Woman has been a favorite song of mine and Wilner ever since I heard it when it first came out.
It is one of the greatest compositions ever. I mean, combined with the way his quartet and Ornette played it, everything music could be.
And not a day goes by where I'm not humming that. It's not your standard jazz thing where this guy solos and this one solos and this one solos. This is a real composition that brings all of them together, and they're all such staggeringly great players.
From oppression, jazz is at its heart political, and throughout his career, Charles Mingus often integrated his political beliefs with his music.
Charles used his bandstand as a soapbox at all times. He spoke out about his beliefs, about racism, about the inequities in society and the record industry, whatever was on his mind, he expressed.
The most timely and influential track on Mingus-a-um, Fables of Phobos, was no exception. The track spoke of events that took place after the outlawing of segregation 2 years earlier in 1957.
President Eisenhower is signing the Civil Rights Bill. It was Monday morning, 10 past 8. Kids going to school all over the country as the president signs. And in Little Rock at 10 past 8, Arkansas National Guardsmen under orders of Governor Faubus challenging the law of the land, preventing 9 Negro youngsters from attending the Central High School in Little Rock.
There was an attempt to integrate a high school in Little Rock, Arkansas, according to the law, according to the Supreme Court of the United States. Governor Orville Faubus, the governor of Arkansas, would not allow integration.
Mingus was outraged by what he saw happening to people. And the irony of the Fables of Faubus is that it's kind of a comic tune.
It has a theatrical quality. You know, and you're expecting this character that's going to be, not very fit for public display. And that's certainly the way that he felt about this white supremacist governor of Arkansas.
Then came the Eisenhower-Faubus meeting. Finally, Faubus withdrew the guardsmen, and the Negroes entered the hitherto forbidden white school. A riot started. Confronted with what he called anarchy, the president ordered United States soldiers into Little Rock. The regular army troops, paratroops, escorted the Negro children to and from school, gave them full protection from the threatening crowd.
Charles wrote some smoking lyrics about this, and Columbia Records would not let Charles include these political words on the album. Tell me someone who's ridiculous. And then his drummer would respond, Governor Faubus. And Charles would say, why is he so sick and ridiculous? And Danny would say, 2, 4, 6, 8, brainwash and teach you hate.
No, no, Ku Klux Klan, name me someone ridiculous, Danny.
Governor Faubus!
Oh, why are they so sick and ridiculous?
Fables of Faubus, even without the lyric, just the fact that he's using the name Faubus, is going to have a very strong message to many of the people who are listening to that album in 1959.
Fables of Faubus opened up a lot of the like pent-up feelings that we all had as African-American musicians against racism in America, kind of set the stage for each of our own individual expression of that opposition to racism.
Three words. Yes, we can.
Barack Obama may not know it, but jazz is one of the reasons he was elected president. And Charles Mingus and all of these musicians, they helped to create the atmosphere that led to people respecting a person beyond the distinctions of color.
In the years leading up to Kind of Blue, Miles Davis had begun to make an impact with his own defiant demands for respect, both as a black man and as an artist.
I remember seeing him in Los Angeles at a club. People who turned up were gamblers, pimps, drug dealers, hustling type guys, bragging about who got the most hoes and who got the prettiest hoes, and your hoes should be picked up by the dog catcher, and well, you know, just all that kind of stuff.
when Miles Davis came on the bandstand, though, they shut up. They didn't make any noise after he came out there. See, I'd never seen that before. Because these are not the kind of people you can just shut up. And they knew if they got loud and irritated him, he would turn around and leave. And that would be it. He wouldn't come back. Nobody was going to entreat him. Oh, Miles, you won't get paid. I'm not broke. He'd always made his point that when I come in here, I have some kind of artistic goals I'm trying to accomplish, and they do not include you talking while we're playing.
Miles struck me as somebody who would sell a lot of records because of his cool, almost disdainful demeanor on stage. Worked absolutely in his favor to become a talked-about artist.
Columbia had a very powerful publicity department. They realized what we have to do is we have to create this image of the distant, remote jazz musician who's not available to everybody. We're going to sell them that.
And of course, being remote and unavailable just made everyone dig Miles all the more.
Miles was not just a musical pioneer, he was a pioneer as far as American culture in general. You know, he was an important black figure who made it within this American system. He's reaching white America in a big way.
Freddie Hubbard said, when he was in the Village Vanguard, he noticed this repeatedly, that when Miles Davis would play a ballad and put the harmon mute in the bell of the horn and play in the lower register, he said every woman's legs in the club opened. And he said the first time he thought he was hallucinating, that it was not really happening. He said he looked, they didn't even know they were doing it. He said they would all just open up.
He was a dude, man, a dude, but beautiful. So sexy, if you really want to know the truth. He's got a very elegant, low-key sound. You know, the women liked him a lot. Look at all the wives he had.
While 1959 saw America beginning to find its groove, beneath this shiny surface lay deep fears brought about by the Cold War with Russia. As part of a program of cultural detente, the American government asked Dave Brubeck to take jazz and its American values to the East.
Our government wanted to impress people that were right on the border of Russia about our culture. President Eisenhower wanted us to go along the perimeter of Russia. And we opened in Poland, and then went to Turkey, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India, Iran, Iraq. We were going to represent our country, and we talked about how difficult it is to go and be the voice of freedom when you don't really have freedom yet, because the old unwritten laws of segregation. A great thing jazz has done for our country, and here we're being sent out to do it for the world.
The tour was to begin in Poland. But this meant traveling through East Germany.
East Berlin was not recognized by the United States. So they assigned Madame Gundulach, that for some reason could go through the Brandenburg Gate. The whole scene was like a spy movie. She told me to get in the trunk of her car. I said, I won't get in the trunk of her car. I'll get in the back seat, and if I get questioned, I'm going to tell them the truth. But she got through. She brought us to a police station, and this man walked into the room and said, "You are Mr. Kulu." And I said, "No, I'm Mr. Brubeck." And he said, "No, you Kulu." Then he pulled out a Polish paper with a picture of me, and the caption said, "Mr. Kulu." And I realized I was Mr. Cool, and that was my name. Many of the ideas that we developed for Time Out came from touring in these countries, like Blue Rondo a la Turk. That's a Turkish folk beat. Diet, 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 diet. And then it goes into a blues.
4-4-2.
Brubeck returned to the U.S. with a complete vision of the time signature experiments for Time Out. Album of cool rhythmic innovation, Brubeck decided that drummer Joe Morello was to be given a showcase.
I heard Joe playing this beat backstage, and I said, "We'll have something in 5-4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
That's right up my alley, man, you know. It was just spontaneous. I was looking for more colors, you know, different textures of sound.
Boy, this is fine. This is gonna work. Time Out was going where I envisioned jazz should go.
Jazz history had been written in 4-4 time. And you get Dave Brubeck doing a whole album with the idea of using different time signatures.
Columbia told me all these crazy time signatures, that'll never sell. But the disc jockeys started playing this. We had a big hit.
The idea that jazz could actually make it onto pop radio in America in the late 50s, that was totally unheard of. What really works well with Time Out is that it provides an easy introduction for mainstream America to deal with new musical ideas.
Toward the end of 1959, the Ornette Coleman Quartet came to New York for the very first time with the prophetically titled The Shape of Jazz to Come. They were all but unknown, but those who were hip to the scene were there to check out the band's New York debut at the Five Spot.
We couldn't wait. Went down to the Five Spot and had a rehearsal one afternoon, and then we opened up. There were lines around the block. The place was packed with people, so it was quite a deal.
The opening night, they had everybody. Everybody was there. So he was kind of on auditory trial, so to speak.
And we couldn't wait to get to work and play because the music was so great and new and fresh.
And that's when The Shape of Jazz to Come is, dropped on the New York jazz scene.
First night of Ornette's was a socko impact and unforgettable. I don't think I ever heard four musicians who gave me the impression of surrounding me. I was in the middle of it. Bang.
We all know the atomic bomb is very dangerous. We must get ready for it. Duck and cover. Atta boy, Tony. Act fast.
Coleman spoke the paranoia that existed in the nuclear age. The reaction that many people had just to this idea that the entire world could be blown up.
To play music with this urgency, this desperate urgency, to make something new that's never been before, as if you're on the front line and you're risking your life for every note you play.
Well, I was there the opening night, and I was really unprepared for the hostility. I was sitting next to Roy Eldridge, and Roy was a warm, generous guy, and he was listening to Ornette, and he said, "He's just jiving, man. That's not music."
People were saying it was random, it was chaotic, it was this or that.
There were people who became angry at the music and let it be known that they hated it.
In New York, everything was under suspicion. And I didn't know about being under suspicion. I just thought about picking up my horn, activating the idea that's going through my nervous system.
This guy had extreme nerve. See the things that Ornette would play, even today, you actually cannot believe that he played some of them, just the sheer audacity of it.
In New York, Ornette Coleman playing his white plastic sax was considered pretty out there, too.
It looked kind of funny because, as people said, "Oh, well, what happened to the candy that was inside it when you bought it?"
He got a great sound out of this instrument, man. You wouldn't think it was plastic. We'd be playing, and I'd say, "Oh my God, I hope this horn don't melt, man. This cat's playing some heavy stuff, you know."
It's hard to understand a negative reaction to that. Something so fabulous. I mean, like, what would people object to in it? I can't even imagine it. He changed everything. He changed everything. The whole approach, the way of looking at it, the style of it, the sound.
He influenced people that don't even know he influenced them, who like think they hated the music. You know, it gets into you, because you can't help it. Maybe that's what upset them so much.
I'm not trying to prove anything to anybody. I want to be as human as I can get, believe me. And there's nothing I'm trying to hide. There's nothing I'm trying to climb above. There's nothing I'm trying to destroy. No one is going to suffer from what the human race does, because it's not going to destroy itself. It's going to improve itself. Music is something that, to me, is nothing but the sound of your emotions. It's your heart, it's your feelings, it's your belief, it's your ability, and most of all, it's your love. And what's so beautiful about it, it's not destructive. It's always something that gets better.
'59 was a really important year in jazz, because you had some of the greatest musicians in the world playing a response to what had been played, but was also a response to what could be played. The art was advanced in 1959. Another set of choices were provided for everybody.
Miles Davis, Kind of Blue, has become jazz's best-selling album. Hugely influential from its 1959 release right up until today.
Kind of Blue definitely changed music. It just kind of opened up the horizon for jazz expression.
Miles would go on to influence the course of jazz many more times. Dave Brubeck still continues to follow his own groove, and Time Out remains a high point of jazz innovation.
With Time Out, it finally happened the way we all dreamt of it. It stood the test of time, this one.
Charles Mingus, a political as well as musical force, is now recognized as being among the 20th century's most important composers. Mingus-a-um remains a prime work by this unpredictable genius.
He was sharing his emotions about life. The message he always said to sidemen was, play yourself. And you could extend this to all of us. Play yourself. Be who you are.
But the record that has most changed jazz in this last half century is Ornette Coleman's The Shape of Jazz to Come. It came out of nowhere and fired a starting gun on new forms of music. The LP still sounds radical.
He's divisive even to this day. Being divisive is a defining element almost to Ornette Coleman's music.
The legacy of The Shape of Jazz to Come will be to create no boundaries, to play new music as much as you can, not to be satisfied with the status quo.
Next week, Arena profiles the meaning of cool. That's next Friday at 10 as our look at jazz 1959 continues. And there's more jazz coming right up with the Dizzy Gillespie Quintet. Next.